Couple quick things. I got a note from Rhonda Green about the prayer shawls. If you pick up one of those prayer shawls, make sure you write your name down as to who picked up one of those so that we know where they've gone. Apparently there's a couple missing that we didn't know where they went, so just make sure you let us know. Assume the book is right there available and good to go. Okay. Second thing, following down in your bulletin, I had a note on the missions trip from Jean Hope that there will be a meeting. Let's see, Sunday evening, that's next Sunday, the 22nd at 8 p.m. Jean, where is Jean here? Not even. I assume there'll be an information meeting about the Tanzania trip that's going on in October. And you all know October's going to be here before we know it, so they have some information on the expenses, what they're working on. It looks like they were talking about the garage sale, which was apparently a pretty big smashing success. So, much appreciation for that. VBS is coming up right around the corner. And Courtney and Sherry have asked that if you would like to provide some cookies for VBS, which is, holy moly, that's next week. If you want to provide some cookies for VBS, make sure you talk to Courtney or Sherry. They're leading that thing up, so keep an eye on that. Okay. I also have a note from Delbert Gladys who wanted to say thank you for all the cards they received. It's good to know that whenever we have a family in our church in need, there's always a whole lot of cards and good thoughts that goes everyone's way. I have a couple other things for prayer for others that we'll be doing. Is there any other announcement that I missed? I thought there may have been someone else to talk to, but yeah. Okay, Richard's going to be in the hospital this Monday. Is it tomorrow? Okay. Let's head into our prayer time where we're gonna we'll pray for others and we will also pray for our offering. We have as always, a pretty extensive list of those who are in need of some of our prayer for healing and for a variety of situations. A couple of notes on that. I have here for Lois Lester, who has cancer, which is Amy Cope's sister's mother-in-law. Did I get that right? Okay, yeah, I got that right. So you may remember Lois Lester. And also please remember to pray for the Dean family and their children and their continued safety and speedy return home. So, and from my own personal group, I've had several people have asked about my brother. My brother Chris, as several people know, he was actually involved in the camp for several years back many moons ago. But my brother Chris, in the last couple weeks, has been diagnosed with stage 4 kidney cancer. It's pretty serious, but he's undergoing treatment, and they're hanging in there. So they're working on it. So if you'd keep them in your prayers, we'd appreciate it. Is there anyone else who had some prayer for others that we need to bring up before we go into some prayer time?
Hey, I think we need to keep Kristen Buster in our prayers. I think she's in KU Medical Center right now.
Okay.
She's had a long bout of what's going on in her life. And really need to be praying for their family.
All right. We'll keep her in her prayers. That's great. All right, well, let's take a word of prayer here, and then we'll get our special music going for this one. Lord, we just thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the rain you've provided, Lord. God, we thank you for this house that we have a chance to come together with fellow believers and just have a chance to worship you, Lord, and a chance to learn more about you and to grow closer to you, God. God, we have so many people with so many physical pain and so many other emotional and spiritual pain, God. We pray a blessing of the healing that only you can provide and the peace that only you can provide. We pray, God, that we will always remember to remain faithful to you and to seek you first, even through the challenging times of our lives. Lord, we pray for the gifts and offerings that are provided to this facility. We pray that we, as a church, will use those productively and efficiently, and that we will find the best ways to grow your kingdom and to reach more souls for you, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. volunteer it to the time. Please stand as we worship this morning.
Oh,
again. I want you to know those of us who come up here and do these meditations in the pulpit, it's definitely something we don't take lightly. And it truly is an honor to come up and have something to share. And what I think I enjoy most about it is I know that every time I'm scheduled for this, something is going to happen. Something is going to happen for me to share with you. I'm completely convinced every time I know that something's going to come up. And the story I'm going to tell you about today happened, I knew immediately, oh, that one's going to be told in the poll, for sure. And when I ended up switching with Mark, and when I didn't realize immediately that it was Father's Day, I laughed at the time, because the timing is always perfect. But if you want to flip over to a verse, I'm going to use a verse today. It's in John 16, at the end of John 16, that I'll mention today. But my story today is, of course, about my children. It's Father's Day. You probably ought to have a story about your children. And the story today is going to be about one of them in particular, and it's about my youngest son, Truett. And Sherry had the pleasure of working with him today. He's something else with him. And what you should know about Truett is Truett has a nickname. And the nickname around our house for Truett is, I call him Hot Rod. And for those of you who've had the joy of having Truett over to your house, it's pretty obvious why I call him Hot Rod. Because if you have any toy at your house with wheels, you will find it. If it's got wheels on it, and he can make it go fast, especially if he can ride on it, you're going to find Hot Rod on that toy at your house. Guaranteed. That's what he does. So, the other day, Hot Rod and two other of my children, three of my kids and I, we were at the park. And I was doing the typical dad thing at the park. You know, one kid sees one toy and the other wants to go do it, and they all kind of do the thing, right? So one wants to go swing, so they all want to swing, right? So there I've got three of my kids on the swing, and of course, you know, none of them can swing very well, right? So what do you got to do, right? You're playing like musical swings, right? Like you push one, you know, you get them going, and you push the next one, you get them going, you push one, and you get them going. So, you know, Griffin and Brinley are pretty good at the swings. You know, they're school age, they can hold on pretty well, you know, so I'm getting them going pretty good, you know, going underdog and getting them swinging. Of course, what does Hot Rod want to do, right? He's the youngest, monkey see, monkey do. Push me higher, Daddy, push me higher, Daddy. So, I'm getting them going, and I give him a good swing to get underneath them. Pushing, he's swinging really well, and I watch him, he looks like he's doing fine. I turn around to go push his sister on the swing, and I hear, thud. And you know, after you've had four kids, you know that when you hear the thud, you calmly turn around, walk, don't freak him out, just casually walk over there, you know, and he's laying face down in the wall. He fell out on the backswing. Right, so he was up over my head, and he was face down in the mulch. You know, so I pick him up, you know, he's got mulch stuck in his face. You know, and he's kind of got the wind knocked out of him. You know, when you pick your kid up, and he's got the wind knocked out of him, you know. And they're doing the thing, you know. And, you know, I'm picking the mulch out of his face, and saying, you know, hold him there. It's all right, but it's okay, buddy, I got you. You know, you're all right. It's okay, I got you. And I'm waiting, right? And it seems like forever before they take that breath. But you know, what's he going to do as soon as he takes the breath? What do they do when they take in the breath? They're going to scream. He's going to let me hear it. Because I pushed him too high, fell on his face, it's all my fault. So I'm sitting there waiting. And finally, I get the mulch out of his face. You're okay, buddy. I swear, this the words he said. He finally takes in a breath, doesn't let out so much as a whimper, and he goes, push me again, Dad. Just one more time. That's Hot Rod. That's who he is. And I laughed when he did that. Of course, I put him on the swing, and I pushed him again and got it going again. But why did he know? Why did he tell that to me? Why did he say, push me again just one more time? Well, partly because he likes to go fast on it. But partly because he knew he was going to be all right. He knew even though he had fallen down, even though he got something that was going to leave a mark on him, even though something that was going to give him some pain, He knew he was going to be all right because his dad was there. And the story that I want to look at is at the very end of John 16, the last couple verses of John 16. And in John 16, it's right before Jesus is turned over to be crucified. And he's telling the disciples what's going to happen. And he tells them in verse 31, it says, "Do you finally believe? But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when you will be scattered, each one going his own way." Jesus knew that all of these men who had been following, his loyal followers, they were going to leave. They were all going to scatter. They were going to deny him. Everyone was going to run away. But he says, at the end of this verse, he says, "Yet I am not alone because my Father is with me. I have told you this so that you may have peace in me." Jesus knew what was coming. He knew he was going to have a mark. He knew it was going to hurt. He knew what was coming. But yet he knew he was going to be okay. He found peace and comfort because he knew his dad was going to be with him. And that's what we do as fathers. And what makes this verse even more wonderful is I love the end of verse 33. It says, "Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows. Take heart, as I have overcome the world." And that's what we need to remind even our little children, is that we have a heavenly Father taking care of everyone. He's overcome the world. Even though we're going to fall out of the swing, we're going to get a mark on us, we know who's overcome the world. And we're going to go out. So let's remember our Heavenly Father who's with us, and the one who got the mark for us, so that we have a chance at heaven. Let's go to this prayer time. Lord, we thank you for this chance we have to come together. We thank you for this communion that we have a chance to share. We thank you for mostly what it represents, the huge sacrifice provided for us. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to give a chance to make it to heaven. We thank you for the grace that and the forgiveness that gives us the opportunity to get you there. We pray, Father, that we'll use this time to reflect on our lives, to think about how we can better serve you, that we can find ways to grow your kingdom. Pray this in Jesus' name.
Face.
and write it at some point today. Maybe by closing song.
And she's in job.
She's still on. chin. Janet's still alive. And but Janet's baby, LaDonna's grandma. And you'll see her soon, Natalie. That's how she became Natalie.
All right. Dad's on his way. And I told Miss Jessica, it's okay to have a Monday on a Sunday. Okay. I have one, like when I introduced them the second time. I remember Emberlyn now, but that's okay. We're going to do Get Acquainted Camp this week. Jordan and Jamie are the Dean and Deanette, I guess. And we're looking forward to it. Now, what time am I preaching tonight?
We think 6. We'll let you know. I don't know. I'll text you.
I appreciate that. Always good to know. And because I'm preaching at the camp, I will not be here. I need to know two things. I need to know how many of you are going to be here tonight to watch Courageous. You got to raise your hand because that's the only way we're going to do this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That was worse than the 13 from the other day. 6, 7, 8. We're at 8. All right. All of you 8. If you would like, we would do this another time. Dwayne won't be here. I won't be here. You guys will have to leave singing and the whole deal. Or we can say, you guys spend time with your dads and your families, and we will pick it up next week. Okay? Are you following me? Yes? Nod? Smile. All right. If you're okay with not having it tonight, you're one of the 8, raise your hand. Boy, there they are. Okay. Go enjoy your family. And I'll know where I'm preaching tonight. But Dad's on display. Oh, we got some Dean of Men here. Isn't that right? Larry and who'd you tell me the other one was? Was it? Where'd he go? Here he goes. It's Larry and who are you making Dorm Dad?
Larry and
Larry,
I think.
Larry and who?
Larry.
Just Larry.
Both Larrys.
Larry and Larry.
All they need is a third brother Dave.
We're going to have a good time this week. We really are. I've always enjoyed working with them. It's never failed. Take a look at Dad's on display. This is what I want you to see out of Titus 1:9. We should bring glory to God in all we do, especially at home. If I can get one message out to you as fathers, if I can get you one message out to future fathers, it would be this. We should bring glory to God in all we do, especially at home. And our text presents 3 motivations of all of us, or for all of us, to continue to do well for our own families and for our spiritual family as well. He wants us to do well with this family, men, and men to be. He wants you to do well with your church family.
You may lead it up someday. You want to do well while you're in the learning stage. Don't put it off till you become an adult. You're that much further behind the curve if you put it off. First motivation of all of us, to continue to do well for our own families, for our own spiritual families. The first dad on display is our Heavenly Father. He is the motivation for us to do well, I would say. He's the motivation for all of us as dads to do well. All of us as boys, all of us as men to do well. And he's not sexist. He wanted to be a good example to you as females also. Our Heavenly Father provides for us a purpose and a plan. Verse 1, Titus 1. Paul, a bondservant of God and apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness. His purpose. We might not all be apostles, but every one of us who are Christians are bondservants of God, slaves of the Master, Jesus Christ. And usually it's bondservants of Jesus, but this is one of two places where Paul speaks about us being bondservants of God. Actually, the other wasn't Paul at all, it was James who said it, being a half-brother. A purpose for us. We aren't gifted necessarily to be apostles, not one of us in this room. But he has gifted all of us. And he has given us, therefore, a purpose in the body of Christ. That's where we live out our purpose, for the body. It wasn't an individual gift just meant for you. God's gifts aren't really his gifts until you give them away. And you share them with others. A purpose. He also had a plan. He said, Paul, a bondservant of God and apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God, and for the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness. First one, for the faith of those chosen of God. It was an amazing thing. When you read a passage like this, to think that before the foundation of the world, he chose us in him. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. And then he says, he gifted us. He appointed us with a purpose and a plan for the faith of those chosen. So he's got people that he's going to put in our life. Whether they're believers or non-believers, he puts both in our lives. So that he uses the gifts in our lives to reach out to them. It's when we sit on those gifts. It's when we stop being a Christian out in public. It's when we think this is the only place we're supposed to be a Christian. That we shortchange the people that we were assigned to. Get a load of the way that's phrased. For the faith of those chosen of God. For the faith of those chosen of God. I feel like a Christmas tree up here. Keeps on shining in different colors. It's real pretty. I want you to realize you've got a purpose. You have a purpose. Whether you're male or female, you have a purpose. And it's for the faith of those chosen, even if they aren't Christian yet. Even if they aren't Christian yet, you are in the place where he's got a plan for you. It's just up to us whether we're going to do it or not. Or whether we're going to make an excuse as to why it's somebody else's job. Only you have the influence with your family like you do. Only you have the influence with your friends like you do. Only you have the influence with your classmates and workmates like you do. You've got to do it. You've got to be that one. A purpose and a plan. Our Heavenly Father provides for us. Notice how it works in your own house. Ephesians chapter 5 and 6. Ephesians chapter 5 and 6. He says this in 25. Husbands, this is how you do it. You love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, set her apart, make her special, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church glorious, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we're members of his body. For this cause, a man shall leave his father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I'm speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also ought to love his wife as himself, and let the wife see to it that she respect her husband. This passage of Scripture points out a plan and a purpose within our own family. And he makes the dads responsible, spiritually speaking, not just for guidance, but for protection. And when dads go into a marriage and they refuse to be that spiritual leader in their family, or they try and convince the wife that it's her job, they have reneged on a job that started being reneged on in Genesis chapter 3 when Adam watched Eve take a bite. And then she hands it to him and says, oh, it's good, here. Where was he? And you have to realize God's still asking when we renege on this responsibility given to us by God and hand it over to our wife. We are the spiritual head of our household, whether we want to be or not. And he expects it to happen. And don't expect him to be all smiles when you let your family crash because you just won't do it. For whatever reason. He has a plan. He has a purpose. Let's work it. And he promised us in verses 2 and 3. He promised us in verses 2 and 3. He says, in the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before times eternal. That's really what it says in the Greek. Before times eternal. He promised this to us before we ever existed. Before the world ever existed, he promised us eternal life through Jesus Christ. But at the proper time, manifested his word, who happens to be Jesus, and also our preaching at the same time, in the proclamation with which I was entrusted according to the commandment of God our Savior. I love this passage. It tells you that God is our Savior. I'm going to go one step further here in another verse. Our Heavenly Father promised us concerning our future. He promised us concerning our future. He said, the hope of eternal life, which God who cannot lie promised before time's eternal. You have eternal life coming. You really do. Now, here's the kicker. How you live your life, how you make your choices down here, dictates where you spend that eternity. That you are all going to rise forever. You're eternal beings created in the image of God, and you will live forever. In one place or the other, but you will live forever. It really seems like a no-brainer on where we ought to be shooting for. And where we ought to be shooting for our family. Because they're on the front line of our life. No excuses, hands down. He promised us concerning our future through his word. Through his word. Get familiar with the word as much as you can. Jesus Christ, yes. And the written word, yes. Get as familiar with it as you can. If you don't know where to start, start in the book of John. Follow that up with the book of Matthew. In and tells you all about Jesus. Those two gospels are the most valuable. Proverbs, James, practicality. How do I live out my spirituality on this planet? Proverbs, James. How do I stay happy? How do I get over stuff? Philippians. That's where you start. That's where you start. He promised us concerning our future through His Word. Notice what He has left for us as dads. Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6, 1-9. Notice what He's left for us as dads. Now this is the commandment, the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God has commanded me to teach you, that you might do them in the land where you're going over to possess it, so that you and your son and your grandson, see how he goes through the generations, might fear the Lord your God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged, not just on this planet, but especially in heaven. Verse 3, O Israel, you should listen and be careful to do it, for it may be well with you, or that it may be well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you in a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, then, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. Because that's when you do your teaching at home. Because they're on your heart. And you can't hide them. That's just who you are. And you shall teach them diligently to your sons. And you shall talk of them when you sit in your house. And when you walk by the way. And when you lie down. When you rise up. You're teaching them about Jesus all day long. Through the good times and the bad times. The way Jesus did. And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates, especially the doorposts of your heart, is really what he's looking for. And then in 20 to 25, he continues, when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what do the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments mean which the Lord our God commanded you? And your kids will ask you, Daddy, what's this mean? Daddy, what's this mean? Daddy, what's this mean? You've got to help them. Then you shall say to your son, we were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt. You have to talk about who you were enslaved to, the devil. And the Lord brought us from Egypt with a mighty hand. He took us away from Satan, and he delivered us. Moreover, the Lord showed great distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household. He continues to answer prayers for us every day, kids. And he brought us out from there in order to bring us in and give us the land which he had sworn to our fathers. And we talk about heaven over and over and over again. So the Lord commanded us to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always and for our survival as it is today. And there's a lot of people not convinced that this has anything to do with their survival. How you live down here has everything to do with your survival. You've got to be making wise choices, not just for you, but for your kids and your grandkids. And it will be righteousness for us if we are careful to observe all this commandment before the Lord our God, just as He commanded us. Proverbs chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. Proverbs chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. This is great advice. You can use this. To know wisdom and instruction, to discern the sayings of understanding, to receive instruction in wise behavior, righteousness and justice and equity, to give prudence to the naive, to the youth knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning, and a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. To understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. Here is the real capstone. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Hear, my son, your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching. Indeed, they are a graceful wreath to your head and ornaments about your neck. My son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. When sinners say to you, let's go do this, God won't care. He does care. When they look at you and they tell you, God isn't here. There is no God. He is here, and there is a God. And as the movie says, he is not dead. He is not dead. Second motivation for all of us to continue to do well for our families and for our spiritual families. Dad's on display, our Heavenly Father first and foremost, and our spiritual fathers have been on display for us. Think of somebody, a male, that influenced your life in a spiritual sense. Your spiritual dad. The one who made a difference in your life. A spiritual dad. Our spiritual dads, we have a common faith with. And our spiritual dads make us responsible to continue on doing, to continue on being everything Christ wants us to be. Verse 4 in Titus 1. To Titus, my true child, according to a common faith, grace and peace from God the Father, Christ Jesus our Lord. Our spiritual fathers, we have this common faith. And according to Romans 1, 16 and 17, it keeps us going. And it keeps going from faith to faith. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. For everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. And where you start with your own kids. And you don't have to be a dad, you can be a mom. That's where it starts with your kids. It is transferred from faith to faith. And it goes on, and it goes on. But the negative side does too. The negative side does too, and we got to stay as far away from that as possible. Our spiritual fathers, we have a common faith with, and the faith keeps going. And we have identical equipment. We have identical equipment, grace and peace from God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace is extra supernatural strength to get something done when we can't do it ourselves. That's what grace is. It's a supernatural power that takes over when we need to forgive, when we can't. When we need to give, when we can't. When we need to share, when we can't. When we need to understand, when we can't. He keeps on equipping us with grace and peace all the time. So we don't have to worry about our future. We don't have to worry about what's going on right now. Spiritual fathers in a common faith keeps us going, and we have identical equipment with our spiritual father. And our spiritual fathers make us responsible. We follow instructions and we set in order. You know that's what we do in church? We follow instructions and we set in order. Whether you're talking about the eldership to the youngest member, we receive instruction. We receive the orders, and then we set in order. Great, great instruction here in verse 5. For this reason I left you in Crete, that you might set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Titus, I want you to do this. I want you to set everything in order. I want you to take care of what I assigned you. We all have those assignments, and we all need to take care of these things in the congregation. There's never a newsletter. There's never a bulletin. There's never a Sunday that passes that you and I don't know what ministries need filled right here, right now, by us, because we are it. There isn't anybody else. It's us. And we're the ones. And we got to keep doing it. We keep doing it. We need to follow instructions. Remember when Jesus washed the disciples' feet, John 13. Got done, and they really didn't understand any of that. He looked at them and he said, "You don't understand what I've done for you, but I need you to understand this. And what's more, I need you to copy. I need you to imitate. I need you to do exactly what I was doing." He said, "You call me Master and Lord, so you're right, for so I am. As I have done to you, so you should do to one another." Whether it's washing feet or anything else in the body of Christ, he gives you your assignment. And we're to set an order. Set an order in the church and set an order in your life. 1 Thessalonians 5, full of one-liners. How do I live a Christian life? What does he expect from me? How am I going to work this out with my spiritual family? How am I going to work this out with my physical family? Verse 12, 1 Thessalonians 5 all the way to 22 says this: "But we request of you, brethren, that you know those who diligently labor among you." You get to know your leaders, it really helps. "And have charge over you in the Lord and give you instruction. And that you esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Live in peace with one another. And we urge you, brethren, admonish the unruly, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all men." That's our assignment. That's never changed. "See that no one repays another with evil for evil, but always seek after that which is good for one another and for all men. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophetic utterances, but examine everything. Hold fast to that which is good, abstain from every form of evil." That, in the long and the short of it, is Christian living, with Christian responsibility written all over it. We're supposed to set this stuff in order in our life, and then we're supposed to set this stuff in order in our church family. And we have a lot of work to do. The third motivation for all of us to continue to do well for our own families and our spiritual families. We are dads on display, especially our Heavenly Father, our spiritual fathers, and our spiritual leaders. Our spiritual leaders are our spiritual fathers in this definition. Titus chapter 1 and verse 6. Namely, he's talking about appointing elders in every church, in every city. "Namely, if any man be above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children of belief, not accused of dissipation or rebellion." We'll stop right there. Take the lead at home for those in your charge and for yourself. Take the lead at home for those left in your charge and for yourself. At the end of verse 6, our words that are poorly translated in the New American Standard, dissipation and rebellion. It is two negatives of a positive thing that he wanted to be done. Dissipation is an unwillingness to stand under, an unwillingness to submit. That's what dissipation was translated as. But it's a picture of an unwillingness to be under the authority of Jesus Christ. To me, that's a picture of rebellion. When you're supposed to be here as a child of the King, and you're out here, and you're saying, "I'll do it my way, thank you very much. And you'll still love me, and you'll still take me to heaven. You owe me." What gravitas. What hubris. We humans take to God, make him his. Our prayer is his order. "God, my wish is your command." Yeah, right. Read your Bible again. You might have missed a line or two. Read it again. And you're supposed to take care of yourself. And the second word, rebellion, is actually the word not savable.
it's the verb for save, and then it has the not not save. Because a rebellious person, according to Samuel, practices, might as well practice witchcraft and divination. He says, I have not desired sacrifice, I have desired obedience. Rebellion and insubordination is as witchcraft and idolatry. And he told King Saul that, right, when he was removing the kingship from him. He still can't stand it. Don't tell me you're a teenager. I have this right to be rebellious. No, you don't. You signed on to Jesus Christ, you obey. And you not only obey, you submit. That means you're willing to go under, because submission doesn't happen unless you're willing. Spiritual leaders take the lead at home. Spiritual leaders are God's stewards. It's not your house, it's His. It's not your family, it's His. Verse 7, above reproach. The overseer must be above reproach as God's steward, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, not fond of sordid gain. These spiritual leaders that we choose are supposed to be above reproach. And you're the spiritual leader in your household, and you need to be above reproach too, men. There's no excuse, there's no vacation, there's no time where they're not looking at you. There's no time where they're not patterning their life after yours. You don't get a free pass. You got to do it. You got to be it. It only works one way, and that's if you're a Christian. 1 Peter 1, 13 to 19, 1 Peter 2, 4 to 12, or 9 to 12. Talks about being above reproach and setting the pace. And we'll close with these words if the praise team wants to come forward. 1 Peter 1, 13 to 19. Therefore, gird the loins of your mind for action. Be sober. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As children of obedience, do not be conformed to the former lusts in your ignorance. But according to the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all behavior. Because it's written, you shall be holy, for I'm holy. And if you address as Father, the one who impartially judges according to each man's work, conduct yourselves in fear during the time of your stay, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with the precious blood as of a lamb unblemished and spotless of Christ. Of Christ. Chapter 2, verses 9 to 12. You are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you did not receive mercy, now you receive mercy. Beloved, I urge you, as aliens and strangers, to abstain from fleshly lusts, which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the non-Christians, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, on account of your good deeds, as they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. And the weird part about that is, He's equipped us. He's given us a plan. He's given us a purpose. Are we giving these people, He said, in our path, a day of visitation? Or are we passing them by? Are we giving them a day? Are we giving them a day of visitation, letting Jesus be seen in us? Or are we passing them by because we got stuff to do, places to go, people to see, on our time? Our time, our importance, and God, you'll get what's left over, really, I promise. What does God think of
how you've been living. What does God think of the example you've been setting for your kids and grandkids and great-grandkids? We can always do better. We can always do better. But we sure don't want to blow it off. Pretend like it's not real. Pretend like God's this goody guy that's going to just let everybody in. It really doesn't matter how you live now, because he's not. He's the judge. And he is just. And he died to save you. And if you don't want him, he won't force you. But there will be an eternal price to pay. Trust me. And you can't say you never heard it. Because there's a little short guy that was turning blonde again. He stood right up here. I told you so. You have a decision to make for your Lord. You do it as you stand there.
Cause I've heard it.
You might do an all call, just in case, for those that didn't show up tonight, and then nobody's here. Because they didn't see those eight people raise their hand. Have a good week. Have a good Father's Day. Spend time together, especially at camp. Good stuff. Pray. Father in heaven, love you. Thanks for loving us. We pray that we'll be good examples for those kids out there at camp. We pray that we're good examples for our own kids, whether they're at home, whether they've already gone. Help us to take up the mantle of leadership in our own family, our own life. And help us to be all you've called us to be and all you've equipped us to be. And quit being satisfied with mediocre. Help us move for you and for those you place in our path before it's too late for them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.